Well, good morning, everyone. If we could invite you to take a seat, we'll try to dive back in for one more push. First thing logistically to name is that from 10:30 to 11, we will take a genuine break. So if you haven't checked out yet, please use that time to check out, like Nicole's note this morning suggested. We're going to try to do 25 minutes from Brad, 20 to 25 minutes from Bell, and then over to you. Okay, so this is essentially Faith Angle tries to do big think, to get away and retreat and rest a little bit and do big think conversations. And this morning's is in the sweet spot on that front. We're trying to talk about marriage and shifting patterns in family structure and what that means for men in particular, who, as Christine mentions in her landmark piece in the Post last summer, are falling behind, as Bell's friend Richard Reeves has talked about and is working on now full-time with his focus on men and boys, and also helped to inform today's panel. For men, for women, for American welfare policy, for civic life in a time of strain and polarization, what's the marriage play? What's going on with marriage? What the trends are? How does religion affect marriage? How does changing patterns and cohabitation and the like, what's in play? Melissa Kearney recently wrote a great book that some of you have read called The Two-Parent Privilege. It's been very sort of data rich, and she also weighed in on this panel and suggested these two panelists. We think this is just the right pair of scholars to talk about some of these issues. Brad Wilcox, who teaches sociology at UVA, where he also directs the National Marriage Project, has been studying marriage like a hedgehog, not like a fox, like a hedgehog, for a very long time, for over 25 years. How does marriage influence well-being? What's it mean for kids? And Brad has just published what I think is his most accessible and most compelling book that's just replete with data, called Get Married, Why Americans Must Defy the Elites, Forge Strong Families, and Save Civilization. How do marriage patterns differ by class, by education levels? How does religion, as we mentioned, impact marriage? Is divorce really down? Why do most people still aspire to get married? How are screens and technology impacting dating and cohabitation? Are boys raised without a father in the home really as more likely to go to prison than to go to college? This book covers all of that and more. Brad's a non-resident fellow at AEI since 2013. He's a senior fellow for the Institute for Family Studies, which he co-founded in 2009. And he writes regularly for Deseret News with some of you in the room. And he will be speaking alongside Belle Sawhill, who is an emeritus senior fellow at Brookings, where she ran the Center on Children and Families and was vice president of its economics program. Two of them have been friends and sparring partners and mutual champions of one another's work for quite a while, all aimed at advancing well-being of children and families, as I mentioned, for quite some time. Belle is a careful reader of Brad's new book. And while she may differ on some of the culture war type questions, I think you'll hear a lot of complimentary insight on questions around poverty, work supports, screens, incentives, and perhaps even religion. She has a forthcoming chapter wrestling with the impact of social media, in particular on screens for young people and family life, as well as some proposals for interesting possibilities, IUDs and birth control, and new ways of helping to prevent unwanted pregnancy, particularly amongst teens. I hope she'll talk, as we mentioned also, about maybe the impact of religion in all this as well. Belle was associate director of OMB under Clinton, the Clinton administration, a huge job. She's authored six books, including a 2020 piece called A New Contract with the Middle Class with Richard. And you could read more about each of them in your program. Okay, so big think, Faith Angle conversation on marriage and poverty and what, if anything, religion has to do with it. Brad.
Great, thanks Josh for having both of us here today to talk about marriage and family America. Let me kind of just begin with a quick question. Could you raise your hand if you'd like to be happy? Okay, so you're most of you are not alone. Our civilization is a nation dedicated, as Jefferson wrote in the Declaration, to the pursuit of happiness. And you know, I think probably many of you are aware that the happiness trend in America is not sort of headed in the right direction. We've been seeing data from Gallup and from the General Social Survey showing us that kind of American happiness is hitting record lows in recent years. And from my perspective, one reason why happiness is falling and also deaths of despair are rising is that what I would say is the American heart, if you will, is closing before our very eyes. Our civilization is in the midst of an epical shift away from marriage and all the fruits that follow from marriage, children, kin, financial stability, and so many opportunities both to love and be loved by another. And from my perspective, this is dark news because, as Aristotle said, we are social animals, and we thrive most when we have deep and abiding ties to other human beings. And for many of us, no such ties are as important as those found on the family front. So what I'm talking about, for instance, is just to kind of look at, you know, some of the slides here that are around the table, is the U.S. marriage rate has fallen more than 60% since 1970. And what that means practically is that about one in three young adults today will never, we think, get married. And we've kind of never been in this demographic territory where so many young adults today will kind of move into midlife and later life without the benefit of a spouse. That's also, of course, linked to dramatic declines in fertility. We have hit 1.6 in 2020, probably going to hit that again in the next year. And we're projecting, my colleagues and I, further declines in fertility. And again, what that means kind of concretely is that about one in four young adults today will never have children. So that means that a lot of Americans will be kinless in some kind of fundamental way. Now, of course, there are plenty of voices in the culture today who don't think that this is really a problem. From the left, we can get articles from the New York Times saying things like, married heterosexual motherhood in America is a game no one wins. And now from the right, we're kind of getting a similar message, but not targeting women, as is often the case on the left, but kind of targeting men, with a similar kind of message, a kind of anti-nuptial message. I'm thinking of Andrew Tate, for instance, who says, quote, there is zero advantage to marriage in the Western world for a man. So again, there are voices now on the left and the right who are kind of discounting the importance of the kinds of trends that I'm discussing this morning. But from my perspective, in a world that's marked by increasing economic inequality, in a world where many of us are addicted to what I would call electronic opiates, in a world where many folks are reporting more loneliness, and in a world where I think more and more of us are kind of unmoored by a kind of rising normlessness, I think it's kind of in this context, actually, that marriage and family don't just matter, but probably they matter more than ever. And in the sort of the pack of slides that are here, you can look at sort of the link between family structure and child well-being on the left here, and then also the associations between family structure and women's happiness by marital status. So when it comes to kids, for instance, what we see is that kids who are being raised by intact married families are more likely to be flourishing in school and in college. They're doing better when it comes to the risk of depression, and they're much less likely to, you know, having trouble with the law, in this case, be incarcerated. And in some of these outcomes, we're seeing that the sort of association between family structure and kids' outcomes has grown stronger. So when it comes to school suspensions, when it comes to college graduation, when it comes to young adults' odds of kind of reaching the middle class or higher, we see that the link between family structure and those three outcomes has grown stronger in recent years. So again, I'm suggesting to you that marriage matters, and in some ways may matter more than ever for, you know, for our kids. And then for adults, we can see here, there's been a lot of media speculation that, you know, marriage and motherhood are kind of like a path towards misery for women. And then now on the right, you know, the same for men. But for the average woman, there's no question that women who are married, especially women who are married mothers, are more likely to be happy with their lives compared to women who are not. And the same basic pattern holds for men. So, you know, there's no question that on the sort of the emotional front, women are doing better if they're married with kids. And then financially, too, what we see is that adults who are stably married, both women and men, are in a much better position than their peers who are not married. And when it comes to poverty, one of the topics of today's morning conversation, we see that men who are married about 50% less likely to be poor, and women are about 80% less likely to be poor, even net of controls for things like race and ethnicity and education, if they are married compared to not being married. Now, when I came out with kind of the title for the book, there were some kind of some critics of the subtitle about defying the elites. And in particular, Matt Iglesias, you know, was making the point that, well, the elites actually are doing pretty well when it comes to marriage and family. Why would you be talking about kind of defying the elites? And to be frank, it's a little bit ironic because he wrote a piece for Vox that was entitled, "The Decline of Marriage Isn't a Problem." Okay, so again, he wrote, "The Decline of Marriage Isn't a Problem." And so kind of even he is kind of emblematic of actually the point that I'm making in the book, and that is that our elites are often kind of in their own private lives leading a kind of very marriage-oriented, family-oriented way of life, but in kind of their public positions, they're often kind of discounting or denying the value of marriage and family as journalists or as professors or as school superintendents or as Hollywood moguls. And so when it comes to kind of defying the elites, the point that I'm getting at is we need to kind of recognize that today, unfortunately, many of the elite messages we're getting on sort of marriage and family or on the virtues related to marriage are not particularly helpful or conducive to forging strong and stable families. And of course, there are some important exceptions here at this table, as all of you know. But I wanted to kind of make that point in terms of being clear about why I'm calling for defying elites. And the slide that actually is titled Family Unfriendly Elite Messaging here gives you a more kind of empirical sense of how this is currently playing out in our culture and in our country. And so what the figure on the left is showing us is that today, college-educated, self-identified liberals, and this is from the American Family Survey, which Paul Edwards has had a hand in, only 30% of them would say that kids are better off if they have two married parents. And of course, they're the much bigger group among the college-educated set today, as compared to 91% of conservative college-educated Americans. So you can kind of see how in this demographic, more left-leaning, well-educated Americans are more likely to kind of discount the idea that marriage matters for the welfare of kids. And we see these kinds of attitudes on a number of different surveys today. And then I think when it comes to kind of giving you an example of the way in which, you know, some of the messaging we're getting from elites in terms of the virtues and character and reality of relationships is not helpful to marriage and family and to relationships more generally, is that there's been obviously a big push for polyamory, even in recent months, in a variety of mainstream outlets. Even there's a new show on Peacock that's kind of, I think it's called From Couple to Thruple, that is sort of rolling out the polyamory idea. And I think, you know, it's just interesting that this is not kind of just some like random appearance in a couple of media outlets. Like, this is actually linked now to pretty marked differences in how more elite Americans are thinking about kind of the norm of fidelity. And we can see here in 2010, in what's called the General Social Survey, a major social barometer of American life at Chicago with federal funding, there is a less than 20 percentage point gap between conservatives and liberals, college-educated Americans, on whether or not infidelity is always wrong. But that gap has grown to enormous levels in 2022. You can see here on the right, it's almost a 50 percentage point gap, which is just truly astonishing. And I think this is largely driven by kind of a desire not to sort of be seen as opposing, you know, polyamory, which has, you know, gained ground among more progressive-minded Americans, particularly younger adults. So the point I'm getting at here is that I think in some important respects, our elites are not giving a very family-friendly or a marriage-minded message, you know, in their public capacities, again, as journalists, as professors, school superintendents, maybe politicians in some cases. Although there's obviously problems on the right there as well. And this isn't helpful given the way in which our culture does, I think, have implications for people's aspirations and for their behavior more generally. I don't want to suggest to you this morning that it's only about culture, though. I think we can think, too, about the ways in which shifts in the economy, for instance, have had a pretty precipitous effect on the fortunes of men. And I'm kind of echoing here some comments and observations that Christina's articulated, both in the Washington Post and elsewhere. So the slide here about the falling fortunes of men kind of shifts our attention to kind of the place of men today. And as I've talked to younger women, both on the left and the right, there has been kind of a concern about the quality of the men that they have access to in terms of, you know, men who are worthy of dating and marrying, men who have a kind of a commitment mindset, men who are doing reasonably well professionally. And what we can see here on the left side of this slide is that, particularly for men who don't have college degrees, a larger and larger share of them are not working full time. That's kind of one indication of the falling fortunes of men that we're seeing. And these shifts, I think, are partly a consequence of changes in our economy that have left a good number of men, you know, high and dry in this new economy. I also would say, too, that our schools are often not doing boys and young males any favors. And Richard Reeves has obviously touched on that reality. And then I would further add, too, that I think gaming has kind of had an effect, too, on adolescent males and their capacity to thrive in high school and college and even life more generally. And the falling fortunes of men kind of in the financial arena are important because what we can see here on the right of this slide is that both women and men still are more likely to kind of grant some importance to men playing a role as a financial provider compared to women. So the fact that men are often doing worse today on the professional front of a job front is consequential for their ability to be attractive when it comes to getting married and staying married. So when you kind of put a lot of these trends together, again, I would say we're seeing marriage fall. We're seeing fewer young adults get married, especially young adults in poor and working class communities. And we have new evidence from University of Chicago economist Sam Peltzman that this is kind of the number one driver of why happiness in America is falling. He says, quote, "The recent decline in the marriage share of adults can explain statistically most of the recent decline in overall happiness." So again, kind of we're having greater difficulty in that classic Jeffersonian pursuit in this country, I would argue, because fewer and fewer Americans are kind of finding their way to marriage and family life. And then Jonathan Rothwell at Gallup and Brookings has also found, too, that when it comes to deaths of despair, kind of the flip side of this, the happiness equation, looking at this from a regional perspective, the number one factor he comes across as predicting deaths of despair is fewer and fewer adults, particularly working class men, are married. So I think marriage is part and parcel of some of our biggest social problems today. So that's kind of the bad news, and I want to just shift quickly to thinking about any good news. And in the book, I talk about four groups who are more likely to be flourishing when it comes to marriage today, and those four groups are college-educated Americans, religious Americans, conservative Americans, and Asian Americans. And you can kind of see who's married in this handout here around the table. And then who is happily married. You kind of can see how in different ways those four groups are more likely to either be married and or happily married. And the point there is to underline both kind of the class story that Bell Sawhill has articulated and others have articulated, and that is, of course, this idea that more educated and affluent Americans are more likely today to be getting married and staying married, and also you can see here to be happily married. And I think that story is well known around this table, but there's also a cultural story which is not as well known, I don't think, and that is that religion is clearly linked to people's odds of being married and being happily married. Being Asian American is clearly linked to being married in the first place. It's also, in other research I've done, linked to being stably married in pretty exceptional ways as well. And then finally, I find a real ideological story here. And when I was doing the book, I initially thought I would just have three groups: the college-educated set, the religious set, and the Asian American set as sort of my three groups who are really flourishing when it comes to marriage. But as I crunched the number with my colleague, Dr. Wendy Wang, we found that ideology was also a big independent predictor of being married and being happily married, and that conservatives stood out even controlling for religiosity, for instance. So they're part of the mix. And religion and ideology and ethnicity kind of just remind us that when it comes to marriage in America today, it's not just class, it's also culture that is consequential in American family life. And then just to kind of wrap up the comments here, I think on kind of just to unpack the religion angle here a bit more, because we are here at this Faith Angle Forum, what we can see is that when it comes to religion and marital happiness, religion and sexual activity, sexual satisfaction, generally speaking, Americans who are religious are more likely to be flourishing on a wide range of marital fronts. And I would say what's particularly maybe striking about this is that some of you may have seen a piece in The New Yorker not too long ago that was kind of profiling Sam Perry, who's a sociologist who studies American religion. And he was arguing in that piece that Christian men were kind of porn-addled and guilty about their kind of struggles with pornography, and that their wives were more likely to want to divorce them. He kind of just left it there. But what he neglected to mention was that, you know, on average, both like evangelical Protestants and then just religious men and couples more generally are more sexually satisfied. They today have more sex. They're more happy in their marriages. Their rates of divorce are 30-50% less than their secular peers. So it's true that for men who are religious and who are kind of struggling with pornography, that is a problem and a dilemma for that particular subset. But he kind of missed the, you know, the bigger picture, which is that on average, religious couples are more likely to be flourishing, both men and women. And this difference in sexual activity is pretty striking. So what it's showing is about 2/3 of religious couples have sex at least once a week, compared to less than half of secular couples. Did not expect to see this kind of gap in the research. And when I go back to 2000, what I find is that there was no gap between religious and secular couples when it comes to sexual activity. So in some ways, you know, religious couples, I think, have managed to navigate some of the newer challenges more successfully than their secular couples. And I would attribute that to a couple of things, one of which is just kind of distinctive religious norms around things like forgiveness and fidelity. And this brings us to the next slide here. We can see that religious Americans are more likely, in blue, to still subscribe to the idea that infidelity is always wrong. And that would be, I think, the kind of thing that would sort of be helpful for couples. I also talk in my book, too, about networks. So we are our friends. We are our friends. And so what we know in the research, for instance, on divorce is that if your best friend gets divorced or your sister gets divorced, your odds of divorce skyrocket. But if your best friend doesn't get divorced in the face of ordinary marital difficulties, or if your sister doesn't get divorced in the face of ordinary marital difficulties, your odds of divorce are pretty low. So I think one thing that religious couples tend to benefit from is having a network of people who are often more marriage-minded and more family-oriented. That's part of their success. And then the final thing that I would say about religion is just what we call the nomos in sociology. This idea that there is some kind of meaningful universe that sort of superintends your life. And so, you know, there is a kind of a plan and a purpose guiding your life. And so when like unemployment hits, or the loss of a beloved mother, or you've got a teenager who's in the psych ward on a regular basis at the local ER, you're more readily able to handle those slings and arrows than your fellow Americans who don't have that kind of nomos, you know, governing and guiding their lives. I also looked at for the, you know, just in part because of Christine's presence here today, whether or not there was a big religious gap and in terms of men's kind of connection to full-time work. And there's a modest gap you can see here, but it's not, you know, not what I might have anticipated here. So that doesn't seem to be a huge part of that particular story for religion. And then I'll just make two more points before turning it over to Belle. So I began by asking you if you're happy. And what I see in my book is that today, despite what you might expect from kind of maybe either lurking or engaging on Twitter, both religious Americans and conservative Americans are markedly more likely to be very happy with their lives compared to more secular Americans and more liberal Americans. And what I talk about in the conclusion of my book is that one big reason that's the case for both religious Americans and conservative Americans is they're more likely to be married in the first place and then happily married in the second place. And both of those two factors are pretty big predictors of happiness and help to account for a kind of conservative premium and religious premium in happiness in America. But because, of course, we're living in a society that's more secular, and it's particularly for younger adults, particularly for younger women, more progressive, and because so many of our working class and poor young adults are having difficulty when it comes to both work for the men and marriage for couples in working class and poor communities, we've seen obviously marriage eroding in more working class and poor communities, in more secular communities, and also in among liberals. So that's in part, I think, why happiness is down in America. That brings me to the kind of final slide here, and we can think about, I know a lot of you are kind of really focusing in your professional work on politics, and I think many of us can recall the work that was done probably about 20 years ago when it comes to thinking about what was titled an emerging democratic majority. And the idea here was that kind of the shifting racial and ethnic and immigrant character of the United States would be kind of pushing us inexorably towards a kind of durable democratic majority. And now that's obviously been called into question, given recent voting and especially recent polling trends. And many of us, I think, had kind of the same expectation when it came to sort of the rise of unmarried or single Americans. We kind of thought that they would kind of push the country in a democratic direction. Because single folks were more likely to lean democratic. But I think the experience of South Korea suggests that that may not be kind of working out exactly like we would anticipate. Because it's true that unmarried women continue to kind of move in a democratic direction or in a progressive direction, as this final slide in the handout shows us on the left here. But on the right, what we've seen in South Korea and what we might be seeing, bless you, here in the United States is unmarried men, younger unmarried men, kind of moving potentially in a more Republican direction. Now, this is kind of one wave at the end here of the general social survey. And I'd want to look at some other surveys as well. But there's other research too that kind of would point us in this direction as well, from Gene Twenge, for instance. So I think what could be happening is that in a world where unmarried men feel often like they're put upon, they're not flourishing, the world's out to get them, they might be attracted, in rising numbers to a more populist, a more macho style of politics, that sort of speaks to their concerns and their fears and their sense that they've been kind of, sidelined or marginalized in today's world and culture. So I would just end off our my comments right now by sort of saying, I think one of the challenges of living in a world where marriage has lost a lot of ground, even though I think it's quite valuable for, for adults and for kids and for the broader country, is that it may be part and parcel too of this, looks like from my perspective, a kind of growing polarization between young women and young men that I think is bad for them and is bad for the country and maybe hard too for our, for our politics moving forward. So with that, I'll turn things over to Josh and to Bell.
Thanks, Brad.
Well, thank you. Brad is absolutely my favorite hedgehog. And you've just heard why he's such a great digger here. I mean, really, if I need to know something about what's going on with respect to marriage and family and related topics, I ask Brad. He is very well steeped in the data, and his new book is a terrific book. I've read the whole thing. I don't agree with every part of it, but I think it was extremely well done. I also think it's timely. And the fact that Brad's book and Melissa Carney's book came out within the same time frame and had similar messages, which, hey, world out there, let's get on board with the idea that maybe marriage is a good thing. And one of them is right of center and the other one is left of center. That's a kind of a little bit of a cultural moment, at least in the kind of networks that we all live in. So I just want to underscore that and think they both have done a service for all of us. Now, I've been studying these issues for decades, although not nearly to the degree that Brad has. And like Brad and Melissa, I'm generally supportive of marriage. I was married myself for over 40 years, believe it or not, and lost my husband, sadly, and unexpectedly in my 60s. But I began working on these issues back in the 1970s, and I did so in response to the so-called Moynihan Report. Some of you are too young to probably remember it, but you've at least maybe read about it. It was about black families and why he believed that the decline in the black family was responsible for a lot of the social ills in urban areas. And it was very, very controversial. And he did point out that this problem in the black community had its roots in slavery and oppression, and that a lot of it was related to the lack of jobs for black men, but he was still very criticized. I mention that history because I think that that history has had an effect down to the present day. Very simply, if you're a liberal elite of the sort that Brad is talking about, why would you get out there on a soapbox and start preaching to the working class and lower income families, and especially given the racial sensitivities, about these issues? So I think that's put a pall on the ability or willingness of these so-called liberal elites to talk about this. Now, I want to say that that I agree with, you know, all of the trends that Brad has so carefully outlined for all of us. And as he notes, the only group for whom marriage still seems to be the norm, if you will, is college-educated Americans. And there is still a pretty big racial gap. And then there are these other groups that he identified who are still getting married. So why has marriage declined? To me, the primary driver has been the fact that women now have the ability to support themselves. And way back when I wrote my very first book on this, I called this the independence effect. And I think that sums it up. Women now have a choice about whether to marry or not. They didn't used to have that choice. They used to be much more dependent on a husband for simple financial support. And they also had less access to public assistance than they now have or have had in recent decades. Another driver, I think, has been the sexual revolution. The fact that young people are having, they may not be getting married, but they are having sex, they are in relationships, and that's pretty much acceptable nowadays. And sex sometimes leads to babies more often than you might think. And in the old days, it led to what we used to call shotgun marriages. I've discovered that the younger generation doesn't know what a shotgun marriage is, but I suspect everybody around this table does. But by the way, the first people to call attention to the decline in shotgun marriages and the implications for the growth of single-parent families was Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen and her Nobel Prize-winning husband, George Akerlof. They wrote a famous paper about this. Now, obviously, as any behavior becomes more common, in other words, as people start staying single more, marrying less, single parenthood becomes more acceptable, sex before and after or outside of marriage becomes more acceptable, it all becomes, you know, a little more normative. So there has been, I think, a very strong interaction here between behavior and norms. And I think Brad was saying that as well, and he says it even better in his book. Just to illustrate how much the norms have changed, back when I was young, we called children born outside of marriage illegitimate children. And there was no stigma about calling them illegitimate children. That was just the common parlance. And when I was in the Clinton administration and working on welfare reform, which, as you may remember, was a major activity in the Clinton administration, he had campaigned on ending welfare as we knew it, and he did that. But we had to get bipartisan support, and the Republicans of that era were obsessed with what they called illegitimate births, and that's what they called them. And they believed that welfare was the source of single parenthood, or a major source. And so the legislation that they had proposed was really designed to try to reduce teenage and out-of-wedlock births. Now the good news, and I really think this is good news, and I learned it as usual from reading Brad's work, is that the share of children born outside of marriage, which is about 40%, you know, it's a pretty high number, it's stabilized. It hasn't risen, I mean, it's going up and down a little bit, hasn't really risen since for the last 15 years. So I think something is going on here, something that's good. Now, that the divorce rate, by the way, as I think Brad has said, has either been stable or gone down since the 1980s. So, you know, you may think divorce rates are high, but they're not going up, and they've been stable for a long time. So divorce is not really the problem that's driving this anymore. And as I say, the share being born to unmarried mothers is also stabilized. Should we worry about all of this? Well, my answer with a few caveats is yes, we should, especially where children are involved. I'm less sure about adults. And I think Brad and I could maybe have more discussion of that or with all of you. But I mean, I think there is a complete, well, I don't want to say it too strongly, but I don't want to say it too weakly. I think there's a consensus within the social science community, maybe not in the broader, amongst the broader public, but amongst researchers, that being married on average is better for children. As Brad said, they do better on many different aspects of life if they have married parents. And I have some stuff in my slides about that based on some very new research that I did last year on it. My caveats. First, there is enormous variation in the effects of marriage. Second, those effects are relatively modest, the effects on children I'm talking about now, especially if you adjust for the fact that married and unmarried parents differ in a lot of different ways. You know, think about the fact that those married parents tend to be more educated. Is it the education or is it the marriage that's good for children? I would say it's both, and it's hard to disentangle them, but we could get into that if you're interested. This is the old thing about, you know, separating correlation and causation. Very difficult in this area, but I think we've done pretty well, and I'm convinced that marriage does matter for children. Now, one of the reasons is because if you have two parents raising you, you have two potential incomes that can be brought into the family, as well as lots more time, lots more energy, different parenting styles, ability of one parent to pitch it for the other when things go wrong. and so forth. So it's both income and it's time and it's emotional support. All of those matter. Now, progressives sometimes look at the income piece of this, you know, the fact that two parents have more income than one, and they say, well, there's an easy fix for that. We should just give single parents more support, more generous safety net, and all will be fine. And I think that's true in theory, but I would suggest that it's pretty unrealistic politically to think that the government is ever going to be able to replace the income of even a relatively low-wage second earner. In most states right now, even if you're in a minimum wage job, you're earning $30,000 a year. And imagine, you know, we're having trouble getting a child tax credit enacted that would provide about $7,000 to a family with a couple of kids. And no, that's a lot less than 30 or even 15 if you worked part-time. I believe on the grounds of compassion alone that we should be supporting single parents more than we do now and helping them in lots of different ways. But I just want to note that it would be exorbitantly expensive, especially if they continued to grow and became, you know, the majority of the population instead of the roughly 30% that they are now. Now, the other way I like to put this is to tell the story that I'm sure you've heard before. It's about a guy that's standing by the side of a river. And there are a lot of children floating down the river, and they're at risk of drowning. And this guy is pulling them out of the river as fast as he can. And he's having a really hard time keeping up. And finally, he realizes there's another guy upstream from him who's throwing kids into the river as fast as he can pull them out. And I really think that's a great metaphor for what's going on in this area. We've had these massive demographic changes, growth in children being born outside of marriage, growth in the number of children growing up in single-parent families. And that, as fast as we're trying to improve the safety net for families with children, the demographics are working in the opposite direction. And when I wrote my last book on this topic, I tried to look at what was the balance between the two. And I roughly figured out, but I haven't done this just recently, that the demographic changes were pretty much canceling out any improvements we'd made in the safety net. So, you know, it's like being on a hamster wheel. What else do I want to add here? Policy responses. Yes, we should talk about what do we do about all of this. You didn't get into that, Brad. You did in your book, but today all you talked about was right. The need to get the message about marriage out there. So in his book, Brad does have some interesting policy ideas. I looked at them all. I thought about what did I think about them. And in general, I thought they were all pretty sensible. And talks about reducing marriage penalties in the tax or transfer system. That's a favorite conservative policy recommendation. But what's new about what Brad says that I liked is he said, well, it's very expensive to do it in both the tax and the transfer system, so let's just do it in the transfer system. In other words, the safety net programs, which do have marriage penalties in them. And furthermore, to keep the cost down and to get the biggest impact, let's just focus on kids under five. I thought that was a very good idea, Brad, one that could get some bipartisan support. He's in favor of more vocational and career-oriented education, as I am. This would be, you know, to help get more men to be marriageable. I want to say a further word about the marriageable men hypothesis. I think, as someone said, maybe Nick said yesterday, this goes back to William Julius Wilson. And the idea that if you don't have marriageable men, and this is particularly relevant in lower income and minority communities, you're not going to get marriage. And Brad showed you that slide that shows that people do want to marry people who are capable of earning an income. I think that that was true in the past. I'm much less sure now. Melissa Carney throws cold water on that thesis empirically in her new book. And another researcher, younger researcher at Berkeley, who's written a brilliant paper in my view on this, has also shown using evidence from randomized controlled trials that improving the earning ability of men with real programs, in other words, doing what we're able to do through policy to increase male earnings, does not have an effect, a significant effect on marriage rates. So two good studies on that. But that, I think, is still something we could debate. Now, you know, my big message about all of this, and I'll try to keep this short, is that I think one of the things we've missed, and there's nothing that I saw about it in Brad's book, and he and I've been over this before, and there's also, even more surprising, not very much in Melissa's book. And, you know, I was a mentor of Melissa's. I was hired her at Brookings a long time ago. And I love her book, but when she talks about my work and her book, she says, well, Sawhill is wrong because Sawhill really focused in her work on this about the need to reduce unplanned pregnancies, because unplanned pregnancies usually or often lead to the formation of a single parent family. And that for decades now, before this recent period of stability, was what was going on. And so my solution is, let's reduce the unplanned pregnancies and births, and then we'll have fewer single parents. And Melissa says that's not the problem, because single parents are not having more children than married parents. And that's true. They're not having more children. It's not about the number of children that I'm worried about. It's about the intentionality. Did this couple plan to have or want to have a child together, or did it just happen? And it's about the timing of the birth, the pregnancy and the birth, coming long before the two people involved were ready to be parents, or even ready to commit to one another in the way that I think we'd like to think married couples do. So that's been a big interest of mine, and in my earlier book and in a lot of other stuff I've written, I have said we need to reduce unplanned pregnancy, and furthermore, we know how to do it, and it's very cheap, and it would save the government money even. I'm not arguing it because it would save the government money, but that's a kind of a secondary benefit. So what am I talking about here? I'm talking about the fact that we have new forms of contraception now, usually called long-acting reversible contraceptions like the IUD and the implant. They have increased sevenfold since the early 2000s. They are now getting to be almost as common as the use of the birth control pill. Add to that the fact that as of this month, a birth control pill, or one version of it, will now be available over the counter. No prescription needed. That is huge. One third of women will tell you that they got pregnant because they didn't get around to refilling their prescription. And when you have to go get a prescription, and then you have to go to a pharmacy, and you have, you know, I mean, it's, we're human and we forget, and this has been an issue. So I think the over-the-counter thing is huge. I think the LARC thing is huge. And I was arguing to some of you last night, especially Will, who is one of my heroes in this area, is that we are moving into a new era where women are learning that it is not hard to prevent pregnancy. And young women are using LARCs much more heavily or more frequently than older ones. And as that catches on, there will be fewer unintended pregnancies. And unintended pregnancies have been going down. And if we got unintended pregnancies down to, they're about 40% of all pregnancies amongst the entire women of reproductive age are unintended. 40%, everybody. For young women under 30 who are not married, it's over 70% of pregnancies are unintended, meaning they either weren't wanted or they came way too early in that woman's life. And so if we can reduce that, we can have a big impact, I think, not just on family structure, but on the welfare of children. I love the way my friend Richard Reeves talks about this. He says, accidents happen. They always will, but we could have fewer of them. But a child shouldn't be one of them. A child shouldn't be an accident. It's not fair to the child, and it's not helpful to the adults either. So I will get off that particular issue, I think, and let me just conclude and summarize. I think the decline in marriage has had some serious consequences. I think it would be hard or impossible to bring it back to the levels that prevailed when I was young. But I think the best strategy for achieving better outcomes, it is to provide education and training and other opportunities to young people so they'll want to delay childbearing and have the motivation to do so, will have brighter futures, have hope, and want to take advantage of the opportunities that are available to them, and combine that with that motivation that comes from being education and trained and having a future with the means, meaning better birth control use, and access to abortion. And we haven't talked about abortion yet, and we should. And I have some thoughts about that, if you all are interested. And if you did that, you could really make, I think, a big difference in the lives of young adults and especially in the lives of the children that they're bringing into the world. I think Brad and I are both proponents of what we call the success sequence. And the success sequence, and we both studied it, and we've both done empirical work on it. And it shows that if you just do three things, get a decent education, work full time, and then get into a committed relationship, which Brad would like to be marriage for lots of reasons, and then only have children after that, after you've done those three things, the world would be a much better place. Poverty rates would plummet. The proportion of people who are middle class would go up. I'm going to be shown this quite well empirically. And it would help a lot. So I'll stop there. Thanks for inviting me.
Oh, great. So first of all, yeah, thanks. All right, let's get these in. We're going to take a real break at 10:30. So let's start with Matt Lewis from the Daily Beast.
All right, thank you. So I would say related questions for each of you. For Brad, the question would be, yes, today people who are married tend to be happier, but is that self-selective? 50 years ago, there were probably a lot of people who were married. Maybe they weren't as happy. Mm-hmm. So does it have something to do with being self-selective? And then for Isabel, you did allude to this, but I'd love it if you could talk a little more about the so-called good old days when everyone was more likely to get married, but maybe it wasn't as perfect as we might imagine.
So great question, Matt. I think this is the key question for a lot of the work I'm doing on adults. So there's no question that because married Americans are more educated, more affluent, more religious, for instance, these are all things that tend to be associated with flourishing, you know, on a variety of different fronts. So that's part of the story, but we do see kind of a gap in terms of happiness in the general social survey from the early 70s when the GSS began to the present. And that gap has grown a little bit in recent years. And I think the question is it just because the married folks are more selective, you know, today versus 1974, for instance? Or is it because, you know, some of the things that I was talking about in terms of our broader society has become, I think, less I mean, there's people who are less religious, they're less engaged in local communities. Maybe having the benefit of a spouse might even matter more in terms of like the social solidarity piece. But we also see some good evidence kind of tracking adults over the life course, you know, and sort of controlling for things like their, you know, education, race, ethnicity, and their emotional state prior to marriage, and then sort of seeing how they do on a variety of emotional outcomes after getting married. And we see kind of even controlling for those factors still kind of premium when it comes to happiness, especially in midlife for married folks. And then finally, we have twin studies. That's probably the most rigorous way of answering your question. And on twin studies, we have pretty good evidence, for instance, that coupled adults, both cohabiting and married, for instance, are markedly less likely to engage in problematic drinking behavior. And because married folks are more stably together than cohabiting folks, I would sort of say, well, that probably suggests that marriage is especially valuable. But to be kind of like the most rigorous to answer questions like yours, I think we would need more twin studies to kind of figure out how much of my story is causal versus correlational. One more point though on the twin studies, we do have a study from Minnesota twins looking at guys, and what they found was that identical twins who were married were earning about 26% percentage points more than their identical twins who were not married. Now that's, again, one survey, although it's a twin study, I'd like to see more, but that kind of more robust evidence that something about marriage per se, in this case for men, is pretty important in sort of changing orientation and behavior.
Pleasantville.
So I think there is some selection that you were alluding to. And I think that when you look at my generation, I was married in the 1950s late 1950s. So you can figure out how old I am now, but I'm feeling like Joe Biden or worse, but but I got to learn to joke about it like he's learning. But yes, because everybody was married, and to not be married was to be stigmatized. There were a lot, in my view, and I respect Brad's research, but there were a lot more unhappy couples, or couples who were, you know, played the role, but their relationships weren't great. And I think the liberalization of divorce laws, which some of my conservative friends and colleagues didn't like, have actually been a great escape hatch for people who were stuck in bad marriages, of which there were plenty. And I do think we need to talk about the gender role issue here. Because as Brad is arguing, and I agree, the fact that men are no longer expected to be providers is kind of unsettling to them. And they've sort of lost their primary role. And Christine has written about this as well, as has my friend and colleague Richard Reeves. And for women, it's probably hard for younger women to understand what it's like to think about Jane Austen. Think about the women in that period. And really, it wasn't such a long time ago. You don't have to go all the way back to Jane Austen, except everybody's read or knows Jane Austen's stories about the young women of those days. If you couldn't find a marriage partner, you were sunk. And so women have these choices now that have been, I think, wonderful for them. And but this has led to, and I have studied this to some extent, going way back to my very first book, there's been a renegotiation within marriage. And one of the things about these highly educated couples is they've done the best job, that first of all, they did the best job at contracepting. That's clear from the data to me. Secondly, they do the best job at negotiating roles. Highly educated men don't get all of their status from being top dog in the family. They're often top dog in the workforce. So they don't mind going home and sharing top dog status with their wife. And so, you know, it's just a very different world. and it has its pluses and its minuses. And I think, you know, David Brooks wrote this. I'll stop there.
Good to it. Nick's colleague, Nick Kristof, New York Times.
Great presentations. And I must say, as I was looking at the data on sexual frequency and church attendance, I was imagining a campaign by the National Council of Churches targeting young men saying, you know, you want more sex, get married and go to church.
Right.
A couple of questions. One, I wondered, Brad, how you respond to Bell's point about that one way of increasing marriage might be to help with LARCs and help avoid pregnancies among young women so they can get married later. And second, your point about ideology and happiness, I've always wondered why it is that conservatives are more happy than liberals and to what extent that is you know, true versus, I wonder whether conservatives are kind of aspirationally happy and think that it is the right thing to tell a pollster, while liberals feel they are kind of supposed to be anxious and concerned about climate change and other things, and therefore they say, oh yeah, I'm, you know, a little unhappy. I wonder if you have any sense of whether that may explain some or all of that gap.
Yeah, so on the first point, I mean, on the birth control point, I think, I think Bell and I are kind of coming at this from, this is where we kind of would have the most divergence in our perspective. And I think that, you know, since she was very instrumental in the national campaign to prevent teen pregnancy as both a key intellectual, you know, kind of godmother and advisor ongoing. And I think that's sort of, it's sort of like they've won that battle in a sense. We've seen obviously dramatic declines in teen pregnancy. We've seen dramatic declines in pregnancy for 20-something women. And so I don't think kind of the issue of, I mean, there are still obviously unplanned pregnancies today. But from my perspective, the bigger issue is the fact that we're seeing, and to back up for a second, I think sort of the good news is that marriage and childbearing are much more selective, much more voluntary, much more chosen in a sense. And that means in part that our kids today are more likely to be raised slightly compared to 2012 in stably married families. So that's, I think we'd all agree that's good news. But from my perspective, the sort of bad news here is that I think our adults are much more likely to be struggling when it comes, and we talked about this last night, dating, love, relationships, marriage, and childbearing. And if you look at marriage and parenthood as generative experiences as I do, the fact that so many adults I think are struggling in this domain and are going to struggle going forward today is for me the big issue. So I'm really more about trying to figure out, not about kind of delaying marriage and delaying family formation, but kind of making it easier for folks in their 20s and early 30s to find a path to marriage and family formation. Now, on the ideology front, I would say that, yes, I think that conservatives and liberals tend to look at the world, obviously, differently, and conservatives are more likely to sort of look around, you know, and sort of see maybe a rosier portrait of American society today than liberals would, and that could be part and parcel of why there is this gap. But we have seen work from Gene Twenge and Jonathan Haidt that talks about kind of the way in which a more kind of catastrophic view of the world has kind of gained hold among young. Pew has also shown this as well with their polling, especially among younger progressive white women. So I think there is kind of a very clear ideological piece that's particularly relevant for that group that's linked to some worse outcomes on the happiness front and the emotional front more generally that suggests that there are some recent cultural shifts since 2014 that are especially relevant for progressives. But I also did a piece for the New York Times actually at Thanksgiving time a couple years ago. And I showed in that piece that for both conservatives and liberals, there's no question that both those groups, when they're married, they're happier. And so you can explain part of the gap between liberals and conservatives in their happiness, again, by controlling for both marital status and also some extent marital equality as well. So so I think part of the ideological gap that we've seen in recent years can be attributed to diverging marital fortunes between liberals and conservatives.
Since he got a call out, can we go straight to Bell's hero, Will Salatin?
Thanks to both of you. On behalf of all the nerds here, I'm just super grateful for all the data you gave us. This is really solid and well substantiated, both of your presentations. I wanted to ask you about, for lack of a better word, what Dan Savage calls monogam-ish, the idea of, Brad, you have sort of this chain of causation from attitudes and messages, mm-hmm. So about to family structure to happiness. You have this chart, the page that says family unfriendly messaging.
Right.
So you've got on the left side, on the right side, you've got a trend, a change in the what college educated people say about whether infidelity is always wrong, and that is a notable shift. But it's not about family structure per se, right? It's about a behavior, as opposed to when you're talking about polyamory and alternative family structures. On the left, you've got, on the left, you've got data about family structure, kids, and about whether the parents are married, but there's not a trend shown. So first question, is right. there also a trend mm-hmm. on family structure? And to the extent that there's any discrepancy, like a bigger shift on the question of infidelity, are there data that show that the changes in attitudes about on the fidelity question as opposed to the family structure question are also changing something that's affecting kids? That is, I'm just holding out the possibility that this polyamory stuff is going nowhere, that is sort of a disaster, but that it's actually a very small phenomenon, and that this change possibly in statements about fidelity might be about monogam-ish, and that these people who are accepting some kind of monogam-ish are still believe in the two parent family and in a stable two parent couple.
And Will, when you say monogamish, how are you understanding that term?
I'm just interpreting right. the Dan Savage version, which is you have a little bit of license, like a little bit of toleration, but that you're not going to break the whole family over this. And that, I mean, actually, I can't get too far into Dan Savage,
but
the idea, you know, even the term infidelity, whether one person knows the other person is doing, what I'm skeptical of is the idea that there's a big shift toward polyamory, toward the idea of let's have a completely different family structure. It's going to be a throuple. We're going to try to raise kids in this or not. I'm wondering whether that's a fairly isolated phenomenon.
So on that latter question, I do think that, and my hope certainly is that polyamory is kind of a passing fad, you know, much like open marriages were kind of a passing fad in the 1970s, you know, as you probably know. So, but my point is that I think the left is, because of its sort of broadly progressive orientation, that is kind of seeing every new development that comes down the cultural pike as basically a good one, which we should baptize, you know. And then also because it's more likely to valorize individual choice, you know, and personal freedom in these domains, the family domains, you know, and relationship domains, that it's not like I'm expecting that, you know, a large share of American adults are going to become polyamorous. But I think we're going to see, you know, some decent minority of folks are going to kind of move in that direction because of this new cultural, you know, warrant that they've gotten from, you know, journalists and other kind of influential culture shapers, and that at the margins will be not very good for them and certainly for any kids that they might have in their homes. And it's just also the point I'd make too is that I think there's no question from the general social survey, the people who people who endorse the notion that infidelity is always wrong are markedly happier in their marriages than Americans who don't endorse that idea. And so, you know, and we have seen, you know, kind of an erosion of support in general for the idea that infidelity is always wrong. Now, whether or not that's going to lead, you know, to, again, kind of some kind of major erosion in marriage and family life beyond what we've already seen is an open question. But what I can tell you is that the support for the fidelity norm has weakened in recent years, and it's focused among younger adults and more progressive younger adults especially, and not endorsing that classic norm of fidelity is also linked to having more unhappy marriages in America today. So but I think this is the broader point here, though, I would say is like, it's just kind of an example of where I think the left's sort of orientation to a lot of newer developments on the family front can can be harmful for them and for the broader culture potentially as well. Yeah, and the first thing too, so we have seen kind of, you know, less support for marriage, you know, being important for kids in, you know, over time in the GSS, the American Family Survey, and the gap between liberals and conservatives that I've seen has grown, you know, in recent years. I think part of the challenge too is that we're living in such a polarized country now today that when someone, and obviously conservative, when someone like me comes out for marriage, the problem with that in part is that my, you know, progressive colleagues, you know, are less likely than to, in today's polarized world, to, you know, acknowledge or embrace marriage. And so I don't have a solution for that reality except to sort of say that, like, you know, insofar as someone like Bell or Melissa Kearney, you know, is flying the flag for marriage and the two-parent family, that can depolarize the issue to some extent and help to potentially renew support for marriage and the two-parent family on the left side of the political and ideological aisle. But polarization now is mapping out, you know, onto a lot of family attitudes in ways that I think are harmful, in part because it's still the case that more progressive-leaning elites have a bigger role to play in shaping, again, things like public schools, universities, the media in general, pop culture. And so when they kind of embrace something like polyamory, I think the downstream effects can be, you know, pretty consequential for a decent minority of folks.
Sorry, just one quick follow-up. Just this specific question, the percentage you say infidelity is always wrong. What's the category before always is like most, was it mostly or almost always or?
Yeah, I'd have to look at the GSS. It's probably.
Has there been a big shift in that
wrong.
Too? Like,
no, it's the always is where the biggest, you know, it's the top category that's lost ground in the GSS, I think, so.
Okay.
Yeah. So the monogamish view might be kind of still relatively, yeah, still is still popular. But I think from my vantage point, I think, you know, any kind of weakening of this particular norm is, well, it's certainly linked in the current adult married population to less marital happiness. So people kind of embrace that the always wrong are markedly happier than those who don't in their marriages. So.
Let's jump, if we can, to Ashley Parker, The Washington Post.
Thanks. This is a fascinating panel. Thanks to both of you. Question for either or both of you. You both seem to agree that outcomes for children are better with two-parent households. But I'm curious, in sort of two different scenarios, it feels like there's more women having children on their own, but very intentionally. So deciding they haven't found a partner, they want to be a single mother, taking very deliberate steps to do that. So that's one scenario. The other scenario is it feels like this is purely anecdotally, but at least in terms of college-educated families, the norms around custody with divorce are changing. And so when I was growing up, if parents got divorced, it often felt like it was dads would see their kids every other weekend and Wednesday nights for dinner. And now divorce, the custody situation is almost always, unless there's extenuating circumstances, like a full joint custody where both parents are equal partners and participants. So I'm curious, in both of those scenarios, is there any evidence or data that the outcomes for the children are still as poor? Or did those things change outcomes for children?
I'm gonna start, Bill.
Go ahead.
So, I mean, I think when it comes to sort of voluntary single motherhood among more elite women, I would certainly, and I think Bella and I would agree on this, would certainly say that they're going to be less consequential than it would be the case for, you know, a lower income mom. But we still see, when you kind of compare apples to apples in Pew data, for instance, that kids in affluent homes who are raised in stably married homes versus kids who are raised in non-intact homes are much more likely to be graduating from college and to themselves kind of reach the upper third when they become adults. So there's still a kind of a meaningful difference. And in terms of, it is true that men are more likely to have a much more involved role in the lives of their kids today in the wake of divorce than was the case, you know, 30 years ago. I think in the main, that's a good thing. But what's surprising though is that on average, as I was saying earlier, when it comes to something like college graduation, for instance, it's not the case that the association between family structure and college graduation has diminished in recent years, it's actually increased. And I think on that score, and this goes back to Melissa Kearney's work, we know that like dads of my generation are much more engaged with their kids practically and emotionally than my grandfather was with his kids. So the absence of having, you know, the engaged dad may be in some ways more consequential for today's generation than it was for, you know, an earlier generation potentially. So
Those are good questions. When I wrote my last book, which was called Generation Unbound, Drifting into Sex and Parenthood Without Marriage, and I gave lots of talks around the country, and I would sometimes have young professional women come up to me afterwards and say, I think you're missing the fact that there are a lot of single mothers by choice, and there are even, you know, networks or groups of such women. But they tend to be older, they tend to be professional, they tend to be women who can make that choice because they have the income and the resources and the desire to do so. If some young woman came to me and said, oh, I'm on the fence, I'm not sure I really want to get married, and I haven't found, you know, there are no good men out there or whatever, and for whatever reason, I want to just be a mom on my own, would you advise that I do it? I'd say only if you're prepared to have all the extra responsibility that it entails, because it's a lot to take on. But obviously, I respect people who take on that choice. And if we have time later on, we can talk about what Dan Quayle said about Murphy Brown. And the Washington Post, you probably don't know this, came to me some years ago on the 20th anniversary of Dan Quayle's speech, in which he said he castigated Murphy Brown for being this, you know, television celebrity who had a child on her own. And he was very critical. He was Moynihan-esque in his criticism. And, you know, then she said, the woman that whose name I can't remember, who played Murphy Brown, said, well, clearly the vice president has not kept up with the fact that we have a diversity of families in this country. And so, you know, this debate goes way back. And, I know people who are doing it, and I admire them, but gee, I think it would be hard.
About one more, and then we'll take a break.
There, it's a small group, too.
Christine Emba of The Atlantic.
Great presentation. Thank you. I just had a clarifying question, mainly for Brad. But, Pell, I'd love to hear your thoughts, too. You already mentioned that you've got a lot of pushback on this idea of elites, that the elites are...
Right. Mm-hmm.
Hiding the idea of marriage. And that was also kind of the pushback to Melissa's book. Who are you referring to when you refer to elites? Is it just like elite progressives? Is it just people of wealth? Is it on both sides? Because you also point out that on the right and the left, there's pushback against marriage. And then following from that, why do you think the elites are doing this? I was interested in the Moynihan Report reference, but I suspect there is something in, I don't know, elite culture in this moment where there is an impulse not to shame, stigmatize, or even advise or prescribe advice to people. But is that hiding information, or is that done out of goodwill? It feels like the two groups are talking past each other a little bit on this question.
Yeah, that's a great question. So again, I would sort of think primarily about kind of culture shaping elites who tend to lean left, you know, and I'm thinking just and measuring it like as I did here, college educated, you know, liberal elites would be kind of the primary group that I'm thinking of, and people who have a commanding role in the culture when it comes to, you know, journalism, when it comes to academia, when it comes to Hollywood, when it comes to education, for instance, like school superintendents would be an example of who I'm thinking about, are the folks who are either kind of being very quiet about marriage or who are actually actively saying that marriage, you know, doesn't really matter and that all family forms are equally valuable for kids. So I would think, for instance, of the way in which, you know, college presidents would be very strong in articulating the value of you know, a college degree for first-generation students, and yet would never articulate to their collegiate audiences the value of marriage and family, you know, for their students. Even these are people that I know, like, personally, who have, like, good marriages, great families, and they can talk, you know, at length about the value of education, but for some reason would never articulate the value of marriage and family to, you know, their audiences. That would be kind of a concrete example of what I'm talking about here. Now, why is it that's the case? Obviously, I think there are a couple of reasons why our elites are reluctant to talk about marriage in public, or who or are actively kind of promoting the idea that it's not important. So one, I think, point here is that they tend to gravitate towards ideas that the real problem is sort of structural realities related to the economy or public policy, rather than culture as sort of like a driving force in kind of thinking about our biggest problems in America today. A second, obviously, point to make is that they tend to prioritize and think about life in terms of having lots of choices, you know, and they're used to making choices in their own lives. They want to kind of preserve choice on a number of fronts for themselves and for Americans more generally. And they kind of bridle at, you know, more classic norms that would in some way, you know, restrict choice on a number of fronts. The third point is obviously kind of this idea that we're kind of moving, you know, in a progressive direction. The arc of history obviously bends towards progress. And so there's kind of like this implicit assumption that every new development that comes down the pike when it comes to family is basically good. And the fourth thing that I would say is there's a lot of sort of implicit social pressure, I think, to not speak out on marriage and family in more elite left-leaning circles. I mean, I've talked to like deans at UVA, at the Darden School, for instance, who will sort of say privately to me, oh, Brad, I love your work, but they would never publicly, you know, say that in their official capacity as, you know, as a dean at the University of Virginia. And that's because there's kind of social norms that you don't kind of talk about these. And this is something that Melissa Kearney talks about in her book as well, at the beginning of her book. So once these kind of dynamics get in play for elites, it's hard for them to publicly, you know, depart from the, you know, the idea you don't talk about marriage in public. So those are some things that are, and finally on the right now, I think what surprised me certainly is that we're now seeing on the online right, people like Andrew Tate and Pearl Davis are attacking marriage from the right, and they're saying that it's a bad deal for men because of divorce and any number of other things. And so it's a reaction though to kind of the way in which marriage has lost institutional and legal and cultural value. And that's had an effect on men, which these actors on the right are now taking advantage of and articulating an anti-nuptial message from the right, but aimed not at women like it is often for the left, but obviously aimed at men from the right.
So. Do you add anything on, like, why don't some elites preach what they practice?
Well, I think it's all been said, and I think you said it yourself when you said it's really out of respect for, you know, different lifestyles, and who wants to be judgmental about how somebody else has chosen to live their life. Now, I do, as I've indicated, believe that the social science is pretty clear on the benefits for children, and so I do think we should talk about that. And I do agree with Brad, because I know not only Brad gets criticized, but Melissa Kearney has taken a boatload of you-know-what from as a result of what she said in her book, and it's all based on pretty good research and careful research, and we should care about the future of children, and we shouldn't think that the only thing we can do for children is change, you know, education or the safety net or something else. We should worry. I mean, the family is an incredibly important institution for raising children. And I don't think we should shove that aside. So I am convinced that if you care about children, you have to worry about all of this. And on the rest of this stuff, I think a lot of it is just, we're in a cultural transition and transitions are difficult. I mean, there is some value to having a set of institutions that are highly accepted across society and that everybody is involved in, and you have some normative or moral coherence around them. I kind of get that. I mean, when institutions begin to change, fundamental institutions in fundamental ways, that can be very unsettling to people. And I think that's some of what Brad is talking about. But I guess where I would differ with him a little bit is we're always going to be going through transitions. Society isn't static. And we're going to be exploring, experimenting with different kinds of families, different kinds of living arrangements. The joint custody thing, as you say, has gotten much more common. So I'm a little more willing to accept that change has to happen, is going to happen. We will adjust to it. Some of it will be good. Some of it will not be so good. And hopefully we'll sort it out in a good way.
All right, when we come back, Meredith McGraw, Matthew Watkins, Maggie Phillips, Zach Davis, Elena Flacabrero, Adele Banks. It won't be boring, but it's 11 o'clock is checkout for the hotel. So if you can get that done, that would really help the cause. Let's resume back here at 11:05, okay? It's 10:35, so take a 30-minute break. Good luck with checkout. All right, friends, if we could ask you to take a seat. We got one last push before lunch at noon and flights. So the first question of the return hour is Meredith McGraw from Politico.
Thank you. And thank you again for hosting this forum. This has been really informative and interesting, fascinating. Josh, you had mentioned in your intro dating apps, and it didn't come up in the presentations, but that's, of course, an increasingly common way for young people to meet either casual sexual partners or potential marriage partners. And so I'm curious what impact the rise in dating apps and the usage of that has had on marriage and how content people are with their partners, or you know, just in general, how that's been reflected in your research. And full disclosure, my sister is an engineer at Hinge, although being a journalist, I can't pretend to know what she does. So.
So I think, I think when we first got Facebook, there was kind of like the sense that Facebook would like lead to this increase in solidarity and, you know, many good ways of connecting people and in important, viable ways. And of course, we've now become, I think, a lot more, you know, skeptical about the role that Facebook has played in public life and common life more generally. I think the same thing could be said about sort of dating apps, and that they were seen as a way to kind of match people more effectively. But my colleague, Dr. Wendy Wang, has found that couples who are meeting in person, you know, whether it's in a college classroom, like I met my wife at UVA, or in a religious context, or in a social event where friends are gathering, are more likely to be happily married than people who are meeting, you know, through a dating app or online. That does lead me to be a bit more, you know, skeptical on that level. But then I think also too that the challenge with dating apps is it seems to sort of privilege people who have, you know, more sort of surface-based appeal in terms of either looks or, you know, other markers that would be easily visible on the app, which tends to sort of like sideline a lot of people who don't necessarily look great on the app for one reason or another, which I think is challenging. And then it does seem to be the case as well, I've at least seen research on this, that women are more selective than men on the dating apps, and that kind of creates some dynamics that are not particularly healthy with the guys who are doing well on the apps, kind of, you know, being less commitment oriented. So netting it all out, I would say I think the rise of dating apps has not been particularly helpful to fostering like serious dating and marriage would be my, you know, my guess right now.
I haven't followed it closely, so I don't know a lot, but I don't disagree too much with what Brad just said based on what I do know. There was one study I remember at MIT where they found that people spend an awful lot of time online, you know, looking at pictures and narratives about people. And then, as Brad says, that doesn't necessarily correlate very well with how you think of what you think of them when you actually meet them in person. And that if you value your time, there are some questions here. I would be reluctant, though, to say that it hasn't helped in our kind of busy society, very large country, et cetera, and people moving a lot with, you know, connecting to people, but it's just a first step. But I don't know, I haven't done any in-depth work on it.
Matthew Watkins from the Texas Tribune.
Hi, okay, and this is on, yeah. Thank you so much for this talk. I've found it very engaging, interesting. I think you've really identified something important and worth discussing. I want to go back a little bit to the conversation around kind of a pushback from the elites, because I definitely sympathize with the idea that there is a certain aspect of reflexive, you maybe could even argue knee-jerk reaction of, you know, especially liberal elites not wanting to kind of tell people how to live their lives. But I also go back to the reasons that you kind of gave at the beginning of your talk, Isabel, about some of the reasons for marriage rates going down, the idea of the independence factor, women not feeling as though they need to get married in order to be financially supported, and also the kind of decline in shotgun marriages, right? And when I hear those two things, I think, you know, that maybe a lot of these marriages are not happening, are marriages where maybe women in particular were entering marriages that, absent those pressures, they might not have felt like it was right for them, whether for compatibility reasons or maybe even more seriously, you know, not feeling respected by their partner or even not safe in their marriage. And in that way, I can see why someone might push back against methods to increase marriage if it's going to bring back those pressures. And I'm just curious how both of y'all think about that, whether that weighs, or am I presenting sort of a false choice there when I ask that question?
Well, I'll start on this one because I agree with everything you're suggesting. And, you know, we have to remember that historically anyway, marriage has been a patriarchal institution. And, you know, even if you look around the world now, not just at the affluent West, but at other societies, you still see how, you know, in the Muslim world, for example, women are very much subservient to a father or a husband. And so it's natural, I think, for women in particular to want to celebrate this new set of opportunities that they have and these choices that they have. And I think there's still negotiation going on about whose job it is once you get married to do X versus Y. And that hasn't gone away. And my young colleagues and friends who have young children, you know, they tell me, oh, well, you know, my husband is totally egalitarian. He wants to do half of the work in the home, but guess who ends up doing it? And I'll tell you my favorite story about this, which is my young colleague who says that her husband is great at going to the store, but would he ever be able to put together a list of things they need or notice that they've run out of milk or toilet paper or something? No, that would be impossible. And so it's not just the hours you spend doing something, it's who manages household time and household chores. And that still seems to be a woman's role. And you know, I don't have to tell all of you that there is still a lot of tension with women feeling like they have to do it all, that they have to have a work at home and work in the family. Home and family. Sorry, I'm still saying it wrong. Home and work. Sorry. But you know, there's a whole set of public policy proposals to deal with that. Subsidized childcare, more pre-K, more paid leave, more flexible hours, more remote work. And we haven't worked all of that out yet.
So I would certainly say that I'm not hoping to go back to 1955, right? And that's an important, you know, point to make at the beginning, responding to your question. But I would say, in terms of my obviously view, is that we're hardwired to connect. We're social animals. And that most of us, not all of us, but most of us are more likely to flourish in the context of, you know, these pair bonds, which we in most cultures have kind of called marriage. And the problem in part today is that I think the Midas mindset has kind of eclipsed the sort of focus on marriage and family for a lot of young adults. And what I mean by that is just kind of this idea that, you know, what matters is education, money, building your own brand, and especially your job. And we know from, you know, polling from Pew that about 70%+ of adults today think that the job is the path to fulfillment. Only 20%-ish think that marriage is the path. And yet, empirically, we know that marriage is a much better predictor of happiness than employment, and that career satisfaction is not as powerful a predictor of happiness as is a good marriage, right? So I just think that our culture is not basically telling young adults like what matters most, and it's not equipping them to forge good marriages. In part, you know, I think too, in terms of just realizing it is 2024, and we can help have men figure out maybe new ways, you know, to manage work and family in partnership with their wives. And we're not doing any of that really kind of practically. We're doing a lot to help prepare them for work, but not for marriage and family. But I think it's also the case too that, you know, I've heard complaints from both women on the left and women on the right, even today, that there's not enough good men out there, not enough marriageable men out there, commitment-worthy men. What I don't think people on the left though appreciate is that is stratified by those young men's or middle-aged men's family of origin, right? And so you're much more likely to get a higher quality guy coming from an intact married family where he's seen his, you know, father kind of engage on the home front, you know, carry at least some part of the load and, you know, be a reasonably good husband. And so I think you're more likely to have problems with young men not kind of measuring up when they're hailing from homes where their fathers were not present and not kind of being. So I think if we could kind of recognize, if we want to kind of raise the quality of men in the culture, we can have debates and discussions about how best to work out the division of labor. Although I would say on that front, it's important from my perspective not to have a 50-50 mindset, but more like a 100-100 mindset. I'm not saying I have to go back to 55, but just to sort of say, we're going to kind of like look at our basket of jobs. We're going to allocate a lot of them just, he's going to do this, she's going to do that, and not have like this debate about, you know, doing things on a 50-50 basis in the home to kind of give the guy like his own special arena and go with that. But so I'm just saying, I think if we could focus more on kind of stressing the value of marriage, equipping both women and men, you know, in adolescence and adulthood to be preparing more for that, devoting as much attention to that as they do towards their careers and education, we'd be in a much better spot.
Start building faith angles, a little bit of free marriage counseling. That was pretty good, Brad. Maggie Phillips with Tablet.
Hi, yeah, thank you both so much. I've actually written about Richard Reeves' work twice. I just had an interview come out with him like last week or the week before. And one thing that he's really big on is ontological security. And it's a
what kind of security?
Ontological security.
Oh, okay.
Yes. And he was like, it's a very nebulous concept. I mean, he says in his book, you can't say, what do we want? Ontological security. When do we want it? Now. You know? And you talked about nomos, but I think that's a little different than ontological security and this idea of where you fit into the whole, right? Could both of you speak a little bit about how religion or spirituality, at least as it's broadly defined, belonging to something larger than yourself, may have a role to play in supporting that? Because it's all, right, like two-parent households, but the fact is people are having fewer kids, people are having less sex, they're not having as many kids. And that speaks to maybe a sense, a lack of ontological security, this sense you have a kid that says that you have faith that there's going to be a future. You're staking a claim in the future, and that means something to you. So, yeah, I guess if you could talk a little bit about, I mean, like Richard Reeves, one thing he's really big on is team sports, you know, this idea of belonging to a group and having an identity in that in a constructive way. But yeah, so either religion or spirituality, how that could help with this crisis of ontological security.
So, yeah, Go ahead, Brad.
Yeah, I mean, so, yeah, I mean, I would just, sort of echo what I was saying about kind of the power of a nomos, kind of this idea that there is this, you know, this meaningful universe. And echoing Peter Berger's, he's a late, great American sociologist of religion. But just, you know, as you probably know, just kind of talking about how having the sense that there is some kind of meaningful order out there. And for many people in obviously the religious world, that's God, you know, endows their lives with greater significance and meaning and direction, and they're better able to handle, you know, the ordinary challenges that face couples in the midst of a long marriage, that help them address things that might be, you know, difficult with their kids today, that we could all kind of imagine. And yeah, so there is sort of, I think, a greater sense of ontological security for religious Americans than there is for more secular Americans. And of course, that's, you know, what's, I think, challenging for the country, in part from my vantage point, is that there are, you know, fewer and fewer young adults who are turning to religion or kind of maintaining their, you know, religion of origin. And so that means that there are more young adults who are living with profound ontological insecurity because they're not living lives that are grounded in some kind of connection to faith or some other kind of clear worldview that would kind of give them that ontological security. And I think judging from the work of, again, Jonathan Haidt and Gene Twenge, it does seem like there are ways in which that's particularly relevant for more particularly left-leaning younger women today. There, you know, that lack of sort of ontological security may be part and parcel of, you know, elevated risks of anxiety and depression for that subset.
I'm not sure I'm going to tackle ontological security. I never heard about it before today. And, you know, if you're talking about people finding meaning in their lives, obviously that's extraordinarily important. And it may be getting more important once we have, you know, climbed some Maslowian ladder of having a certain amount of affluence and ability to think about that more and worry about that more. And I do think there have been traditional institutions that gave people a sense of being grounded in something, in institutional structures. And I don't in any way want to dismiss that. I mean, I really do agree with what I think Brad says very well about the importance of such institutions. But I think there's never going to be any big solution to that issue.
Adele Banks, RNS.
Thank you. Appreciate both of you. Speaking of institutional structures, just noticing that first chart with the decline of marriage, and then there's the decline in houses of worship attendance. I'm wondering about, for the houses of worship that are sticking with it, what you see as their job that might be different now as far as either reaching or helping or working with married couples or even single parent households. What do you see kind of ahead for them, or what are you aware of, maybe your examples of how they're dealing with the very statistics you're talking about?
That's a great question, Adele. So when it comes to sort of what religious congregations could do, I think just doing, you know, a lot more to kind of educate their young adults in, you know, like youth ministries, for instance, about, you know, the nature of love and marriage and family life from kind of their perspective, to kind of, you know, prepare them for the transition into, you know, into adulthood would be helpful. I think having more counseling and retreats for newly married couples, more mentor couples to kind of help newly married couples make the transition successfully to married life. Recognizing that there's sort of in the first 2 years of marriage often a dip in marital quality as people are adjusting to the challenges of being married would be helpful. What we often see in religious communities is there's kind of an effort to help people once they're in crisis, but it would be nice if we could kind of, you know, forestall that by giving couples resources when it comes to communication and conflict and compromise that would help them you know, avoid ending up in a place of crisis in their marriages. I think having more preaching and teaching, both from the pulpit and more ordinary lay context, that also kind of underlines the reality of marital difficulties. I think just sort of like telling people, look, at any one point in time, we'll see about 1 in 5 religious Americans are not happily married. You know, so what that means is in any given, you know, religious community, there's going to be a decent minority of folks who are not happy at that moment in time in their marriage. And just publicly giving voice to that would be helpful in terms of giving people a sense like they're not alone in struggling at one, you know, point or chapter in their marriage. And then working with their new groups like Communio, which is a new kind of national effort to help strengthen marriage and family ministries in both Protestant and Catholic churches, kind of connecting to groups like Communio to kind of be more intentional about these things. And then finally, I would sort of say to be also trying to help, you know, people who are not married, whether they're single parents or singles, you know, feel like they're integrated into the life of their own religious community. And I've stressed this idea that I think going forward, we're going to see a record number of kinless Americans. And so for obviously a long period of time, the church, for instance, has been kind of like a fictive kin, you know, place for a lot of Americans. And so I think churches are going to have to be more intentional about encouraging their members to, and their ministries to incorporate both single parents, but also single and childless adults, of whom there are going to be more in the society at large, but also in the pews as well. So just being more intentional about, I would say, recognizing there's a crisis of I would say, of kinlessness that's sort of going to be growing in this country. And the church has, you know, I think, an opportunity to reach out and incorporate, you know, single Americans, childless Americans in more intentional ways into the fabric of faith community life.
Well, I guess I would just broaden this a little bit. I was thinking about it yesterday when Josh Kwan and the Reverend were speaking, and I was thinking, as someone who is not particularly religious myself, I was thinking about the value of religion in people's lives, which I think, and in community lives, which I think is important. And I was thinking about the different aspects of religion, and I was thinking you can have a personal beliefs, set of beliefs that gives you comfort and meaning, and that goes beyond, you know, that's very spiritual, etc. You can also be part of a community that shares certain norms and values and propagates those values and helps them become influential in people's lives. So that's a second purpose to me of religion. The third is just a sense of community. And I think we kid ourselves in a very large, diverse country of the sort we have, that we can get along without small communities that we belong to and feel comfortable in, feel accepted and supported in. And whether it's a faith-based community, a church, or it's something else, sports team even, we need those organizations, those kinds of institutions. And I've written about this in the context of the decline in social capital that people talk about, like Bob Putnam, but there are others that are talking about it now. And I've looked at the data on that, and you know, the extent to which we as individuals trust one another these days has gone way down. And of course, this is all related to the tribalism and the polarization that we're facing politically, and the partisan identities that have become so strong. And I think these smaller communities can help to break down those, you know, other partisan identities that are becoming so toxic. So for that reason, I'm in favor of faith-based organizations, amongst many others.
Elena Cabrero from the Atlantic.
Thank you both so much. This has been profoundly edifying. I've just very much enjoyed it. I have a question for both of you. I would love to know more, based on your research, about this gap in the percentage of unmarried women from 18 to 40 along these ideological lines. You know, at the risk of valorizing anecdata, having grown up in a very conservative community, but having spent the past 15 or so years of my life in very progressive circles, I have never noticed a distinct difference in my female friends among the desire or yearning for marriage. I mean, occasionally the desire for motherhood, maybe, but certainly not marriage. And so if we can accept the premise that there's not a substantial difference among women based on ideology on their desire for marriage, and maybe we can't, maybe empirically I'm just, you know, totally off base, what then accounts for the gap that nevertheless exists?
You're talking about the political gap that showed up in Brad's slide.
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I think it's related to some of the issues that I've raised about, you know, family planning, abortion, women's roles, and not entirely, but women seem to be more progressive than men. And I think men are at the same time becoming more conservative. I'm going to want to know what Brad thinks about this, because they are feeling less respect than they used to and are struggling with this new role or non-role that they now have. And I think there also is a bit of a pushback against feminism. And that's going on. I don't know, Brad, over to you.
But Elena, is your question, you know, is it that liberal and conservative young women are liberal young women are less likely to be married than conservative young women? Is that part of your question?
Yes.
Yeah.
And what accounts for that gap if the desire for marriage might be, you know, somewhat on an equal plane?
So I think that, like at a kind of deeply personal level, my sense is that there would be roughly equivalent interest in kind of love and relationships and at some level marriage between the two liberal and conservative camps.
I agree with that, yeah.
But there's also obviously a sociological context too, right? So I think it's about kind of what takes sort of practical priority among more liberal versus conservative women. So I think liberal women are more likely to gravitate towards, you know, education and work as key priorities, and conservative women are more likely to gravitate towards marriage and family as sort of more key practical priorities. And then insofar as religion is part of the, obviously, the conversation, if they're, you know, conservative women are more likely to be engage in some kind of religious community, which does tend to facilitate practically, you know, meeting the kinds of guys who are more marriage-minded, you know. So part of the story here could just be even a religion gap between the more liberal and conservative women that would, you know, help to explain this. But Dan Cox at AEI has also found just that conservative young adults are more likely to be, you know, expressing interest in marriage as a kind of an explicit goal of theirs than more liberal young adults. And that would, you know, so again, I think generally speaking, there's not a huge gap in terms of general interest in love, relationships, and marriage, but I think kind of like the concrete commitment to prioritizing finding a spouse and dating with an eye towards a spouse and being the kinds of places that are more conducive to marriage might be helping explain why conservative women are more likely to be married. And I find in the back of my book that the gap between liberal young women and conservative young women in terms of the share who are married has been growing from 2000 to 2021 using the GSS. The other piece though there is, and this is where there's a bit of complexity in terms of just the pool of men, right? So what we see is there's about 2 liberal women for every liberal guy among unmarried younger adults, which I wrote about in The Atlantic with Lyman Stone. And there's about 2 conservative men for every conservative woman among the young adult crowd, right? And so that also means it's easier for conservative women to find a conservative guy than it is for liberal women to find a liberal man in terms of the pool of potential boyfriends and spouses too. That's probably part of the story as well.
I think you should talk a little bit more about the manosphere and the Andrew Tate phenomenon, because he's got a huge number of followers, right? And it's a pretty interesting, if depressing, trend in my view.
So one of the striking things about kind of doing this work is I never would have, you know, anticipated that I would be kind of getting kind of pushback against marriage from people kind of on the right in some kind of way. So coming across Andrew Tate for the first time a couple of years ago, and now this newer woman who's also on the right, Pearl Davis, you know, arguing against marriage has been kind of a newer thing. And they're articulating sort of two sets of issues. One is kind of like the importance from Andrew Tate of like, you know, young men becoming much more, you know, macho, physically fit, strong, aggressive, assertive, dominant, doing well, obviously, job-wise, and sort of embracing a kind of almost, you know, cartoonish model of masculinity. And then both he and Pearl Davis, among others, there's other people in the manosphere doing this as well, are kind of saying that given divorce risks, marriage is a bad risk for men, you know, to bet on. That you're, you know, getting married is going to lead you to divorce court and you're going to be miserable, you're going to lose half your money, you're not going to have primary custody of your children, and so, you know, marriage is a bad deal. So I think that's certainly a new challenge. And I think if we look at the South Korean experience, where we've seen kind of the rise of a much more kind of manosphere-esque, more misogynistic kind of masculinity and conservative ethos to some extent in South Korea, we're seeing that same, I think, dynamic playing out now in the United States. Obviously, many of you are very familiar with it in terms of your writing on politics in the United States. But one of the interesting things about the South Korean case is that there's some new research that Alice Evans has highlighted. She's a scholar who studies gender issues, from a colleague of hers in South Korea, is that it looks like the South Korean men who are most attracted to a more kind of misogynistic or female skeptical mindset are the young men who are floundering, you know, in school and work and life, and also in relationships potentially as well. So again, I think for my progressive interlocutors, both here and more generally, I think one sort of downside to sort of minimizing the importance of reviving the fortunes of marriage is you're going to have a whole pool of, you know, guys who are not in marriage and families, and they may be even more kind of like susceptible to a, you know, a kind of a certain kind of anti-female mindset. Even as I would say too that I think there, when women are not getting married in large numbers, there's also a kind of, you know, polarization taking place with young women moving to the far left in ways that make it hard for, you know, for both our public life, our politics, and just ordinary sociability as well. So does that answer your question?
Zach Davis from Faith Matters.
I wanted to begin by just noting that marriage is what brings us together today. Marriage, that blessed arrangement, that dream within a dream. Thank you for indulging. Elena, I wanted to suggest a theory, an anic theory for me is that my progressive women friends, the years in which they're ready to marry are more narrow. So there's a lot of things they want to get done first, education and career. And when they're kind of ready to commit, it might be a smaller window than conservative women who might be a little more open throughout, you know, a younger period. Brad, I wanted to ask about the relationship of Christianity and marriage in particular. There's a theory that I'm somewhat persuaded by that we're not entering so much as a secular age, but a neo-pagan age, that paganism, roughly meaning personal spiritual practices, syncretic mix of meaning-making, is returning. And you see this in tarot cards and astrology and wellness and culture, et cetera. And that pagan culture has a very different understanding and appreciation of marriage. And pre-Christian eras, you see polygamy and much more informal kinds of mating expression. And the what I've seen in data and phenomenon is that the high status men are having lots of sex, lots of partners using these apps and other tools, And then you've got a whole bunch of left behind men, the incels, et cetera. So Christianity in some ways was an equalizer because it installed in a norm and a moral norm of monogamy. So as Christianity declines, if it is declining, seems to be, is paganism why liberals aren't affirming marriage in the same way? And so will trying to persuade non-believing people that marriage is sacred or important for its own sake going to be difficult? And Bell, I had a question about inequality in marriage. Assortative mating, where super zip types mate each other and create super kids and pass on all those advantages. How's that affecting inequality? It seems like it's irreversible. There's very little cross-class marriage. What do we do?
Yep. Well, I'll start because it's easy to take the last part of your question. Yes, there is much more like marrying like and much less cross-class marriage. It's doctors marrying doctors instead of doctors marrying nurses, et cetera. And that's well documented. And it is definitely also documented that it's increasing inequality, income inequality. You get, you know, two doctors married to each other, they're going to have a big income. My grandson is about to get married. He's a vice president at Citibank, and his betrothed is a biotech engineer. I mean, you know, they're already making an incredible, you know, amount of income. And when they combine the two, it's amazing. So yes, that's definitely going on. And I don't think there's anything, as you just said, to do about it. It's natural. It's a natural phenomenon. The way to react to it is to do something about our tax system and the progressivity of it, right? If you don't like inequality and inequality is getting worse, the way to tackle that is through a fairer tax system.
So that's a provocative question, Zach, and I think it is true that I'm certainly noticing, and this is the Andrew Tate point too, back, you know, to earlier in the conversation, I think that there are a number of voices on the right who are kind of articulating a more, in a sense, neo-pagan perspective, and you can clearly see that their view of life is about strength and intelligence and, you know, kind of giving more benefits to the strong and the smart. And that also kind of carries over into their view about relationships oftentimes and marriage and family as well. So it's much more conducive to a polyamorous or polygamous or casual approach to relationships. And then I would say too, but we do have a lot of evidence in the social sciences about sort of the value of monogamy. So monogamy is valuable for kind of giving more men access to marriage and family life. It reduces, you know, criminal activity. We've got good evidence from this in places like, you know, in China, where you can kind of look at the effect of the sex ratio on who's getting married and not married in China, for instance. And so I think also what progressives don't anticipate is sort of pushing for polyamory kind of undercuts the value of monogamy, you know, as a cultural value. And monogamy in turn is linked to a lot of good outcomes, including kind of having men invest more in their kids typically as well. So I think kind of the move away from a Western model of marriage, a monogamous model of marriage, if we see a lot of that happening, will increase inequality and will make, you know, it'll be even more kind of a winner-take-all society when it comes to love and marriage and family life. That's my quick response here.
How about we maybe make Maria Manzos the last question? And I happen to know that she and Zach go together, so there's a little extra zing in the air.
Well, thank you so much. My question was about sort of improving the social infrastructure that leads to, you know, the decision of getting married and to marry. So what everything? So kind of building on the question of dating apps, but. First question is, what can be improved in that social infrastructure? Also thinking about the place of churches and universities, colleges, and the way that maybe more curriculum-based programs that exist out there that, you know, talk about the importance of marriage, offer some, you know, practical skills. And I guess to end, my second question would be, what gives you hope when it comes to marriage?
So in terms of how can we make things better for young adults, I would say one thing, and I don't know, do you know Hinge? How does Hinge work, Meredith?
Hinge, you have your name, photo, a few right. photos, some prompts that you can choose to answer.
Right.
Like, what's your favorite food or, you know,
sure.
question like that.
But the reason I'm asking is there, some apps are actually oriented now towards like long-term relationships or even marriage. Like there's a new app that's actually... Okay. Yes. Right. More casual.
Right.
Right. So I think dating apps were going to be a part of the landscape going forward. And so trying to basically push apps like Hinge, there's also a new app that was just started here in Miami that's trying to get people, married, you know, with that mindset. So kind of that's one thing in terms of how do we create an electronic world that's more conducive to long-term relationships and marriage. I think too, when it comes to having a mindset shift for parents and professors and peers away from kind of like, this is where Belle and I would disagree, encouraging people to get married in their late 20s or early 30s, that's sort of like the norm, and just being more open to getting married kind of at any point that you're kind of after 20, you know? And so thinking about yourself as sort of like a matchmaker, like there'd be more of a norm that like you ask your friends, you ask your professors, you ask your pastor, you ask your parents, you know, whatever, to kind of keep an eye out for potential prospects. And we're just more intentional about sort of like that kind of matchmaking, helping people, you know, meet potentially good boyfriends and girlfriends that could lead to marriage. And then I think for churches just to be a lot more intentional about creating opportunities for young adults to mix and mingle in a variety of service-based activities and social events, you know, and obviously your tradition's done that for a long time, but kind of extending that model to other communities. And in terms of like my grounds for hope are that, and this is a very kind of anecdotal response, but my own kind of Catholic Who's world, which is the Catholic ministry at the University of Virginia, has become a lot more intentional in the last 5 years about equipping young women and men to kind of think about dating and love and marriage and kind of educating them about kind of what it means to be dating and what it means to be, you know, married, and also doing a lot more to organize things like, you know, dances and other social events that are, you know, designed to foster relationships, and they've seen an upswing, you know, in our own church in young adults getting married, which is not the Catholic norm or generally across the culture. So I think just being more intentional about creating context where young adults can meet one another and be encouraged to acquire the virtues and the values that would be conducive to marriage. But that's certainly very much a small minority of, I'd say, churches and college ministries right now, and I would like to see their numbers increase.
Hope.
I would say one of the most important institutions where people meet a potential marriage partner is the workplace. I mean, you know, virtually everybody in there between the ages of 20 and 30 are in some kind of workplace. And in fact, some of the research that I alluded to earlier shows that people, that some of the programs, that social programs that have been set up to train and help lower income, less educated individuals get become more employable, more skilled, and have successfully gotten them jobs. One of the successive consequences has been they also got married, because when you have a job, you meet people in the workplace and you form a relationship and it leads to marriage. Now there's another side of that, which is we've gotten very interested in protecting women from sexual harassment. You know, it's the whole Me Too movement. And that has put a bit of a pall on relationships in the workplace. The mayor of Washington, D.C., earlier this year announced that anybody in a romantic relationship in the District of Columbia government could not be in the same line authority in the workplace. And now we have the whole thing about what happened to Fannie Willis, et cetera. So this has gotten complicated, and there needs to be some balance between not having one's personal relationships muck up one's work responsibilities, but also not having one's work responsibilities ruin one's chances to make a commitment to another person over time. Interesting tension there, I think.
Sure. I have one real quick story about hope and marriage. I about a dozen years ago, I worked where Brad is now at AEI, and we had this talk from the late, great Michael Novak, who came up from Florida for a speech to a bunch of faculty. And he had a back injury, so the next day I had to drive him to his doctor in Washington. He'd just moved to Florida recently. And so we spent a little time together, and he was asking about life. And I said, we've been married for 7 years. It's a lot of work. It's going really well. Mostly, I think it's going pretty well. He said, ha, ha, ha. He said, you know, my wife and I, we've been married for 62 years. And I just have to tell you, the first 62 years are the hardest. So that was nice.
Can I say something about the hope? Because I forgot that. And I am hopeful. I said earlier that I was hopeful because, you know, divorce rates aren't going up, the share of children born outside of marriage is stabilized, et cetera. And I'm very hopeful because I've been really looking again at the story about birth control, which Brad and I disagree on, and that's fine. But I really think it's so important that we have a goal of making sure that no child is born to parents who don't feel ready and don't want to raise a child. And yes, there's going to be a decline in fertility, and already is, as a result of that. And we can have a debate about whether that's a good or a bad thing. In my mind, it's not a bad thing. I want to see more children who get the kind of time and investment from their parents and from society that can make a difference. And I think with fewer children, we can do that. I'm not too worried about the effects on the workforce or on our ability to support programs for the elderly, because there are plenty of immigrants out there that want to come to this country. And I think this country was founded on on immigrants from other places. And I'm not too worried about increasing the number of immigrants that we take in to replace any decline in the fertility rate. I didn't mean to get off on fertility, but I couldn't resist. But my main point is that the old norm was don't have a child outside of marriage. That's a bad thing to do. That's not a moral thing to do. You're going to be threatened with a shotgun. The new norm needs to be don't have a child until you and your partner are ready and want to have a child. I think that could make a huge difference both to children's lives and to adult lives in terms of more successful family life and less, you know, marriages that were done for reasons that are related to prescriptions about the old norm as opposed to the new norm.
All right, well, listen, you've got at your tables a little feedback form. The most important part of that is the one about are there other journalists you would recommend to come to Faith Angle down the road? This whole thing grows organically, almost all. We do our research as well, but but if you've got two or three friends that would benefit perhaps from conversations along this line, we'd love to have those in particular. If you're willing to just leave them with me, leave them with Nicole, that would be wonderful. We'll be sending you a reimbursement form for Ubers and the like. We haven't said anything about our funders and our guests who are here, but we've got four voices from the Templeton Religious Trust that make it possible for us to do this. Chris Stewart, Cara Ingram, Gene Stewart, and Kimon Sargent. And we've got Paul Edwards from the Wheatley Institution, all of whom contribute generously to make this possible. So go see him if you can. Thank you.